Right, hello everybody. Can you hear me okay? Can you hear me okay? Right, I'm not sure what the sound is like. Is there much background noise? Okay. Okay, that's good. Right, welcome. Welcome along to this rather nerve-wracking cooking session. First proper one I've done. I can see so many people already joining in, 163 people, that's amazing. Absolutely fantastic. And all these people, yeah, I see a lot of familiar faces here, all the usual suspects, and many more. Okay, all good. Oh, Chantel McGregor, hello, how are you? Special mention to you. I watched your, listened to your live feed yesterday. Everyone should go and have a look at Chantel, Chantel's website. She's a brilliant guitarist and songwriter and singer. And she's been doing live feeds about, 5 p.m. every Saturday. And it's really, really good. So Chantel, if you can hear me, paste your website link in and people can go and have a look. Obviously after all this live feed is over, you know. Right. Nice one. All right, let's have a quick look at the ingredients. This will make like a restaurant. A takeaway style portion, so it's going to be a generous size for one, and if you're not all that hungry you could feed two people with it. So what we have here is some oil. I've got about 3 or 4 tablespoons of oil here, so I'm just trying to get it pointed at the camera correctly. Right, we've got some cumin seeds. That's about between 1/2 and 1 teaspoon of cumin seeds, and a piece of cassia bark there. We have ginger and garlic paste, which is, I've mixed probably about 2/3 garlic, 1/3 ginger. Ginger can be quite overpowering, so and that's the ratios I use anyway. We have a teaspoon of Kasuri methi leaves, which I've scrunched up a little bit to bring out the flavour. And then we've got some, about 1.5 teaspoons of mixed powder. I hope you've got this ready. It was in the ingredients I listed. It's about 2 teaspoons of chilli powder. You can use however much you want. 1 teaspoon is sort of mild to medium, I suppose. 2 teaspoons is probably about what you might get in a typical restaurant. And obviously 3, 4, 5, however much you want to add. And I've got about 1/3 of a teaspoon of salt in there. And I've got some of this magic stuff ready, this onion paste, Bunjura, volume recipe in volume 1 of my book. And it's basically onions and spices that have been cooked down long and slow, and it's full of flavour. Smells good. And we have some, tomato puree and it's been mixed with water, a 3-to-1 ratio, so that's approximately about 1.5 to 2 tablespoons of tomato puree mixed with about 5 or 6 tablespoons of water. So there we go. And I'm using chicken for this. You don't have to use chicken, you can use whatever you want. I'm using it raw just to keep things simple and show you how it can be done, cooked from raw. And you could use pre-cooked lamb, beef, chickpeas, prawns. I'll tell you when to add, depending on what you're using, I'll tell you when to add them to the curry. And of course some lemon juice. You've got to have a bit of lemon juice in a Madras curry. Okay, I'll just have a look at the comments seeing what you're saying. Right, no, it's not pre-cooked chicken, Philip. No, it's raw. Okay, 225 people. Wow. Impressive. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the feed. Oh, my God. I just seen a cat in my camera. Hang on. Go on. Yeah. Oh, I didn't mention Worcestershire sauce. You've got to have some of that. It just adds a little depth to the curry. By the way, if you're vegetarian, this contains anchovies, so it's no good for you. There are alternatives. I think Henderson's Relish is one of them that's not got any animal products in it. So, right, without further ado, let's get going. So we've got a choice of spoons, wooden spoon, metal spoon. I'm going to use the wooden spoon for this because it makes a lot of noise when you use metal. Oh yeah, this is my new hob, which is not so new anymore. I've got a burner. If you notice down here, there's a wok ring type burner, which is very powerful. I'm not using that today because I'm going to take it quite slow, just to give everyone a chance to sort of catch up and follow properly. So it's not going to be cooked as fast as I normally would on the high output one. So I'm using this one. Also, it suits the camera as well. It's easier to have the camera pointing at the back burner. Hi Greg, I've got one here, silicone spatula, I'll be using that later. How much bunjura? That's probably about a tablespoon. No more than that. You can use more if you want, more flavour. But this stuff is like gold dust when you make it. You put loads and loads of onion in it, and when you cook it down, it's like reduced to almost nothing. So, you know, you get kind of disappointed that you've only got like sort of a 10 or 12 ice cube tray compartments worth of it. So I tend to use one tablespoon at a time. Right, pan. I'm using just a standard not non-stick aluminium frying pan. This one's a 26 centimeter. It's been well used, as you can see, but it's very clean. In fact, I tried getting rid of that all that staining at the bottom, but to no avail. But anyway, fear not, it's totally clean, and it's a sign of a good pan that it's been well used. Hello, everyone. How many people? 268 people we've got now. That's fantastic. Right. Let's get the gas on, and this is going to make a bit of noise, so I hope you can still hear me above the noise. I'm going to put it on quite a relatively low heat, sort of medium-ish to start with. Let that heat up for a second. Oh, in the background I've got base gravy, of course, the most essential ingredient. Notice it's nice and thin and it's hot, ready to use. So in with the oil. It's about three and a half to four tablespoons. You can use less if you want, but you do need oil for the flavour. there's any oil floating on the top at the end of the curry, cooking the curry, you can scoop it off. But I recommend using at least 3 tablespoons. If you're using induction, then obviously you can't use aluminium, so I would use, try and avoid non-stick if you can, but you could use perhaps a cast iron, heavy bottom cast iron and pressed steel pan instead. There are alternatives, there's many ways to do it. You can use non-stick to make a curry, it's just not quite as ideal. Last saw me at Bombay Brew. Oh yeah, hello Graham. Okay, so the oil's sort of heating up. We're gonna put in cassia bark and cumin seeds. That's about 3/4 teaspoon of cumin seeds and that much cassia bark. Let that cook for 30 seconds to infuse the flavour into the oil. Hi, GC Cressa, we're cooking up a Madras curry. I'm cooking a chicken one, but anyone who's following can use whatever they want. Chickpeas, vegetables, prawns, whatever. This is very eerie because all I can see here is the sound of my own voice and what's going on in the kitchen. Got how many people we've got now? 298, that's incredible. I had no idea that so many people would be watching. Okay, Greg, chicken tikka Madras, nice one. Hi, Rog from Thailand. Okay, we've infused the oil enough. I'd normally have it a little bit hotter than this, but I wanted to take it slow, calmly. And in fact, that reminds me, I'm gonna have a little beer. A book three, no book three planned at the moment. Okay, that's more than enough time for the cumin seeds to get done. It's quite a lot of heat in the pan now. The next ingredient to go in will be garlic and ginger paste. So I'll just let the pan cool down a little bit because otherwise it'll stick and burn very quickly and it'll spit all over the place. The ABV of the Goose Honkers Ale is only 4.3. Alright, so we cool the pan down now a little bit. I'm going to put ginger garlic paste in. Now it's starting to smell really good. How are you getting on with your own cooking? If you can spare a second to type. So the ginger garlic paste is kind of sizzling, and the sound of the sizzling is reducing now, which means that the sort of majority of the water has evaporated. And I'm just going to carry on for that for another 10-15 seconds. Until we see signs of it just starting to brown. We want to make sure the rawness of the ginger and garlic is cooked out. See, I've reduced the heat quite low here. It's very low. With other curries, you often add things before the ginger garlic paste, like onions and peppers, and that mitigates the risk of burning the ginger garlic paste when you put it in. So, okay. Ready to put in the powder. So that's the I've got 2 teaspoons of chili powder, regular chili powder, about a third of a teaspoon of salt, and a teaspoon and a half of mixed powder. All these measurements are level spoon measurements. Now, as you most of you probably know, in fact all of you probably know, powder spices need cooking out, frying, temperatures that can be achieved above boiling point. So I've got this sizzling away. I can smell the raw taste of the spices still. Because I've got it relatively low, I'm not going to risk burning. So I'm taking a little bit more time than I usually would do. So you can follow along. Okay, so that's about right, but we want to put a bit of, just a little bit of base gravy in. You don't need much, maybe 20, 30 millilitres. It's just to give the spices more time to cook properly. How do you know the spices are burned? You get a blunt kind of smell, it's not nice. I think they turn very dark brown. It's with this this curry now, I'm going to put in the chicken. This is raw chicken. Do put in your pre-cooked chicken if you want now. You could add it a little bit later if you want. Same with the pre-cooked lamb and beef. Don't put any prawns in, but do put the chickpeas in if you're using chickpeas or any other vegetable that takes more than a few minutes to cook. If you're using things like peas and carrots, you know, the frozen ones that come in small pieces, you can add those later. There we go. I'm going to turn the heat up a little bit now. Add the Kasuri Methi, which I should have done with the powdered spices. Now, with the raw chicken, I personally use pre-cooked chicken because I prefer the texture and flavour. But it's often a faff to make. This is an alternative. But I think it's important to make sure that the raw chicken is coated to help prevent any moisture escaping and therefore drying out the chicken. Right. And goes to tomato puree. And water mixed. You could use passata or blended tinned plum tomatoes if you wanted. That's what, about 2 tablespoons of puree with 6 tablespoons of water approximately. I'm gonna add a little bit more because I like quite a tomatoey taste to Madras. So I'm gonna turn the heat up further and we can be a bit braver now. Yeah, the mixed powder is basically, well, I'll post the recipe somewhere, but it's on my YouTube channel. But the mixed powder I use is cumin, coriander, turmeric, chili powder, paprika, and a little bit of garam masala. I want the tomato paste to be cooked out a bit, bring out a bit of sweetness in it. At what point during this process do you get the proper BIR takeaway Madras smell? That's from Colin Knight.
Well, I think you get a good hit of it when you put the spices and also the first bit of base gravy in.
Now that's tomato puree is put about nicely. We're going to start adding some base gravy. In this one we've got, we're going to add a ladle. Well, just under a ladle. That's about 75, 80 millilitres, I think. What we're going to do is just mix that in once. And let it cook. Give it a good 30 seconds, 45 seconds. Thank you. Yeah, Jim Rayner, in volume 2 of my book, there's an alternative base gravy which is slightly more pungent. Some people prefer it. I'm just using my regular volume 1 gravy at the moment because I had some in the freezer. So, how's the video quality, by the way? How's it look? Can you see everything clearly? Paul Burrows, could you put onions or pepper in if you want to? You can put some very, very finely sliced chopped onions in at the beginning. It wouldn't really be a madras if you started adding things like pepper in. I think, to me, a madras is going to have like quite a smooth texture to it, you know? You get a nice sort of flocking effect with the sauce. Hopefully we'll be able to recreate that. So, cook that base gravy down. We're going to add another bit more. It's about the same amount again, about 75, 80 millilitres. But you notice it's quite thin. But once it's reduced, it obviously thickens and the flavours intensify. Now I'm going to add, hopefully without any pips, and fish them out later if you need to, some lemon juice. What's that, about 2 teaspoons. I'll reiterate, I'm not having the heat very high at the moment. Normally I'd cook it on slightly higher heat. So it's not reducing as vigorously as it normally would. The reason I'm doing that is to give, you know, to take it slow and make it clear to everyone what I'm doing and give everyone else a chance to catch up, or for me to catch up if necessary. Okay. Mr. C, best way to do your garlic and ginger paste? I would, fresh is best, but you can buy frozen blocks. Which are 100% pure, and they're very, very good. In fact, I'm using those today. But if you wanted to use fresh, just peel your garlic and ginger and chop it up fine, put it in a food processor blender, and bodge your uncle. Add a bit of oil to sort of blend it together and help preserve it. Ratio is about three parts ginger, garlic to one part ginger. So it's heavier on the garlic than otherwise. Excuse my voice. No, it's not a coronavirus cough. In fact, I think I've had the dreaded virus about 3 or 4 weeks ago. It wasn't too bad actually, but I did have the exact symptoms and it was a bit worrying for a day. But I mainly recovered within about 2 days. But it took me about 2 or 3 weeks to really start feeling a bit better after that. Okay, so we've cooked the second amount of base gravy down a bit, and as you can see, it's starting to thicken, and you see a little bit of oil coming to the surface. We're going to add the next, we're going to add the bulk of the remainder of the base gravy now. I'd say that's about 150 millilitres. I'm going to turn the heat right up to the boil as high as it can. It's on the medium burner of a gas stove. If you look in the, if you look here, that's my burner I usually use, which is quite a lot more powerful. Excuse me, that chilli powder is getting to me. Tez and LB, are the ginger and garlic paste in jars from the Asian supermarket good? No, they're not. They're convenient, I'll give you that, but they've got preservative in them and they're a bit heavy on the tartness and they don't taste right to me. Fresh is much better, or frozen 100% pure in blocks is far better than the jarred stuff. All the tube stuff. I think it's time for the onion paste. Let's put this in because it's already cut. You could put it in at any time you wanted, but let's put it in now. Make sure not to waste any of it. Rinse the pot out with a bit of base gravy. Yeah, I'm stirring, I'm doing something that it's not good. I'm stirring it without even thinking, which is wrong. I think it's probably nerves, if you like. I suspect that's what it is, but there's always a sort of tendency to worry about things in the pan and wanting to stir things around, but you must leave it. Leave it to reduce and caramelise. what's different about the onion paste? The onion paste gives a lovely savoury umami flavour. It's not prominent, but it really adds a layer of flavour. Which reminds me, I'll turn the heat down for a second, which reminds me, some of you may not like the idea of this, but you know what's coming next, don't you? Yes, Lee Wiltshire coffee. What I'm going to use is just half a teaspoon, about that much. Just, that's all you need. You won't be able to taste the coffee and the finished result. It stands a certain something, a little piquancy that's quite nice, but again, you wouldn't realise it's in there if you didn't know. So I'll turn the heat back up again now. Right, stop fiddling. Oh, and the other thing is Worcestershire sauce. I'm going to add a good 3 or 4 slugs of that. Has a lovely, again, it's got a umami, savoury flavour. It really adds to the dish, I think. Unfortunately, I don't have any fresh coriander in, but I should have mentioned earlier, if you were going to use it, use couple of tablespoons of these, the chopped up stalks very finely near the beginning, perhaps in with the tomato paste, and then a liberal amount just before the end of cooking. Yeah, stop stirring. You can't really buy it, Chris, onion paste. It has to really be made. I mean, you might be able to buy some sort of condiments or something. There's bound to be something out there, but it's not going to be the same as good as making it yourself. It's worth it. It takes a bit of time, but it's one of those little things that you're so glad you did. Cheers, Carl. Now, see this consistency now, it's thickening up. It's a bit too thick for my liking. I like it a bit saucy, so I'm going to add a bit more base gravy. Just about that much. I'm going to give it a stir. You see, when I just at the bottom of the pan, it's stuck somewhat, which is good. Caramelisation of the sauce and specifically the onions content in the base gravy, and that really creates a great flavour. Normally, because I'll be using a higher heat than this, there'd be more of that evidence. So bear with me on this, it takes a bit longer than usual. Anyway, cheers. There's no product placement there, by the way. Yeah, Colin Naylor, he went to my local, one of my local Asian stores, Packworld. Yeah, it's good. It's good there. They're all good, in fact. One slightly bigger than the other, and they always do good meat, as well as all the spices and rice and everything you can imagine. This recipe serves, as Michael Turley asks, this is like a takeaway size portion. So it will be what you might expect from a takeaway. Most people would struggle to eat the whole thing, but you might be able to feed two people. So I don't know, feed one and a half people on average maybe. Depends on your appetite. Okay. How's everyone doing with the cooking? I'm going to put one of the pieces of chicken in half. Check there's no pink bits in the middle. It looks fine. That I might give it a minute or so longer. Nice sticking to the bottom of the pan. I'll scrape that back in, loads of flavour. In fact, I'm going to add even a bit more base gravy to loosen it up a little bit. I think about 1 more minute we're done. At this point I'll be adding coriander, finely chopped. But some bugger's bought it all. Elizabeth says, smells fab though, cooker is a right mess. Well, it is now, because I've got splashing everywhere, and it happens, you can't really avoid it. I've got some silver foil on the wall behind it, and that's helping somewhat, but believe it or not, this hob is quite clean. If you go back to the beginning of the video, you'd see it was mostly clean. Right, I think we're done there. I'll turn it off. Scrape the fond from the frond, is it fond or frond? Frond from the sides. About ready to dish up. Good. Right, let's sort this out. Who else is cooking, by the way, and how's it going? It's going to be tricky, this, because I'm using my left hand to empty the pan, so I'll do it off camera. Scraping all the sauce off. Don't waste any. You could, if you wanted it a bit sweeter, add a tiny bit of mango chutney or sugar just near the end, but to be honest, it doesn't need it. because there's quite a lot of sweetness coming from the onions that caramelised in the base gravy. Right. There we go. Are you ready for this? There we go. Good, huh? That looks good, doesn't it? There we go. What am I doing? Yeah, that'll do. So, let's have a little taste. To get into this, you know, bit of the chicken off. Yeah, a bit of a close up for you. It's a good idea to let it cool down a bit before you eat it. Things taste a little bit better when they're not quite as hot. And if you can resist eating it now, leave it, go out and cleanse your palate. Well, you can't go out, can you? Well, you can for exercise, but this is not essential exercise. Cleanse your palate, drink water, go in another room, wait for a bit, and come back and eat it, and you'll love it. Okay, shall we go for it then? No coriander, I'm afraid. DDD now. Somebody's bought it all. Right, here we go, going in. Is there anyone else just cooked one and having a taste? Oh, thank you, Mark Cronin. Good of you to say. Mmm. Yeah, that's good. Lots of savoury flavours. Well, yes, the chicken is actually very tender. Often when you cook pre-cooked chicken, when you cook raw chicken, it can dry up and go rubbery. I cooked it in fairly largish chunks. That's a good tip to use. If you were to use small chunks of chicken, they dry out and go rubbery a lot easier. But the bigger chunks hold their tenderness longer. But of course, you would have chopped them in half when you were going to eat them. Okay, shall we go in for another one? Come on, don't you like that? Right, just like that. Oh, nom nom nom. Mmm. Mmm. Yeah. That's so good. Can't believe we've got almost 300 people watching. Oh, something I must mention. Well, it's not like me to miss a selling opportunity. So if you haven't already got my books, here's volume one. I can't really show you in great detail, but it is a book and it's square, I promise you. It's rectangular and it's full of this recipe and many, many more. It's won an award. And this is volume two, which is basically the same shape, but different colours. And of course, the contents are very different. Loads of new recipes. And that's won an award too. Anyway, that's the sales pitch over with. Where's my pan from? I got this from a grocery store, Ocean store, or a supermarket. It's quite a few years old now. I think I started with this one about 7 or 8 years ago. So has anyone got any questions before we wrap up? Colin Naylor, how many books have I sold? I don't like to say, but approaching five figures. That should give you a good idea. But of the paperbacks and the e-books have sold a comparable amount. Ayana's Kitchen. Hi guys, good evening. Does anyone need a delicious recipe of sponge cake? Well, I think after eating all this, you might not have any room for sponge cake, but it does sound quite nice. Did you know, your curry is always sweet. It shouldn't be overly sweet, no. Have you been putting sugar or mango chutney or anything like that in the base gravy? Because that sweetens it up, perhaps more than you'd want. Sarah Peacock, yes, you can freeze onion paste, no problem. Rick Morris, yeah, can you start again? I forgot it was on and have just joined. Should we go again? No, let's not. Well, you can just re-watch this video. Yeah, it's going to be on YouTube permanently now, so you can watch it. I'm thinking of doing another one next week. Yeah, I think seems to have worked okay. I think my presentation skills need some practice, but yeah, let's do another one. Carl, yes, you'll be able to watch this on YouTube. Thanks, Nigel. Very good of you to say. Mark Logan, do Lava Storm. I want to see you eat it. Yeah, I might not be able to talk if I eat that. It's so hot. Rice, yeah, I could do rice. Oh, there's so many. I mean, we'll sort something out. I wanted to do something fairly reasonably straightforward today. As Madras is got relatively few ingredients, but it's sort of, if you get it right, in the right balance of ingredients and the right techniques, it turns out very well. F chili, I prefer to eat with rice usually rather than bread. I sometimes like bread, but it's often rice. If I'm eating out, I often get a naan bread alongside as well. Oh, that's good. What's your favourite type of meat? I like chicken, to be honest. I do like chicken. Oh, God. Yeah, I can't stop taking this sauce. It's really good. Mike, hello, Mike. One of my long-time followers. Yeah, your wife is Indian. Hello. Hello, Mrs. Smith. And she's very impressed. Thank you. Right, I think we're coming to an end now. I think the numbers are dropping a little bit, so now would be a good time to end the feed. So thank you very much to everyone who's come along. It's been absolutely amazing just how many. Over 300 at one point, I think. I couldn't keep an eye on it all the time. But that's very impressive. Thank you very much. And I hope it inspires you to make good curry. And I know some of you have extremely good curry chefs. Okay, so I will say goodbye now. Do a thumbs up. I'm going to scoff the rest of this curry right now. That is how I can find how to stop this feed. Yeah.